Thanks, Pat. Yes, I'm going to present some of the results of the using molecular data. I'd like to point out that we demonstrated in previous work that we can use molecular data to track the activity of the virus in the field. However, we did encounter some difficulties, and we argued back then that the main reason was of the because of the limited data sets that we're using. Indeed, we were using only 68 sequences, and the sequences were limited to the BP60 gene. Since then, we have expanded the data sets. So we have now around about 150 sequences for HDV1, 51 of which are whole genome sequences. And clearly, we are also now working with the HDV2, for which we have a very large number of sequences. So the purpose of the talk today is to get a little bit of more an insight of what's happening with those viruses in the field, and try to see whether we can understand something of the reciprocal dynamics between those different strains. Especially, we were interested into the whether there is some competition between the RHDV1 and RHDV2 strains. So let's start with RHDV2. In this plot, you have the virus population size on the which you can interpret as an index of the virus activity, and then you have time years
on the x-axis. And so the first
thing that I would like to point out from here is the fact that by using a larger data sets, and quite some big data sets, we have a very high resolution. In fact, we can even pick up the seasonality of the dynamic of the virus. You can see that summer month in 2014, and then again in 2015, and probably a little bit early in spring 2015, we have an increase of the virus activity as demonstrated by the vertical line here. And then as we approach winter, so the virus activity plateaus. It doesn't decrease, but plateaus, and indicate it's not spreading as fast as in the spring and summer month. The other element to note in this plot is that it seems that between 2016 and 17, there has been so virus activity stalled. There has been not an increase as for the previous years. It's maintained stable.
And another interesting element that we can
inquire from those analyses is the date of arrival of RHDV2, but that's probably better seen by looking at the probability density of the root age. So here we have on the x-axis the year, and we are trying to estimate the dot is the median estimates of the arrival of RHDV2. In Australia, and the molecular data seems to suggest that it arrived somewhere close to mid-2013, while the first serological evidence there we have is in spring 2014. So it seems as though HDV2 arrived here almost 12 months earlier than we could detect serologically. And that sort of makes sense if you look back at the plot from before. If it is true that it arrived 2013, that's winter, and virus activity has been probably very limited in the period of time. And then only when we arrived in summer 2014 picked up. And then there is a slight time lag in being able to detect the virus serologically. And just out of curiosity, to compare these kind of analysis with HDV1, there are a couple of things that jumps out from this. One is that despite the fact we have number of sequences from these data sets, clearly we don't have the same level of resolution. We don't pick up, for example, the seasonality pattern that we picked up in RHDV2. And that clearly it is because that data set spans almost 30 years. That being said, we do have a similar pattern in terms of general trend. The virus activity increases over time, and then a certain point plateau. That probably starting off 2009 or so, and then there is a sharp decline we'll look at is in a second in more detail. But the first part of the plot, the trend really resembles the same dynamic that we saw in RHDV2, with the main difference being that everything seems to be happening much faster in RHDV2. Similarly, we can look at the date of release of RHDV1. We know the answer in this case, but it is interesting to look at this just to confirm whether we are accurate in it. And the analysis estimates the arrival of the release of RHDV1 in Australia in early 1990. While we know the virus escapes, I think it was October 1995. So, despite the fact that we are trying to estimate an event that happened almost years ago, we getting wrong at the most by 6 months, which is pretty cool. As I mentioned before, an element that we want to look at were any competition between the two strains of the virus, and we decided to use a generalized linear model framework. As happens normally in those linear models, you have a dependent variable, which in our case is the virus population size, and you try to relate that variable to some predictors. And while doing this, you can estimate the beta coefficient. If the coefficient, which is symbolized by the beta symbol here, is larger than zero, you have a positive association. If it is negative, you have a negative association. And if it includes zero, that indicates that there is not a strong, there is not an effect, a statistically significant effect of the predictor on the dependent variable. And so what we have done here is to use the virus population size of one strain and relate that to the virus population size of the other strains. Actually, that was supposed to be two as a dependent variable and one as a predictor. By looking at the analysis, clearly in this case, we have to divide time into discrete epochs. So that's why you have this sort of fragmented element on as it was before. But by doing this, we can compare directly the same time windows between the two strains. And it is quite evident that as RHDV2 virus activity increases, RHDV1 decreases. And in fact, the estimates of the beta parameter comes back as strongly negative. Black bar at the bottom here represents the 95% Haggis probability density, which do not include zero, and for a supportive of a negative association between the two strains, which is very similar results to what Dave was talking about, that RHDV2 seems to have replaced RHDV1. And since we had such good results with those analyses, we decided to take one step further and trying to do it into apply even more complex models. And what we have here is a model that tries to take in account the geographical distribution of the samples. And I have divided the sampling areas in four regions, which are called West, East, Central, which comprises South Australia and Victoria and Tasmania. And what we can do is to look at the virus dynamic within each of those regions. And just to give you a hint of how this works, basically, we still are trying to reconstruct the phylogenetic tree based on the sequence data that we have. But now on the tip of the tree, we have a location attached to it. And the analysis is also trying to estimate what is the most likely location of the ancestral nodes or the internal nodes on the tree. By doing this, we can, for example, look at the origin or the release sites of the two different strains. So in RHDV1, we do know the answer already. We know it was in South Australia, so in the central region, but the analysis recover with a very high confidence that location as the release sites for RHDV1. And when we look at RHDV2, we have a very high, an even higher level of confidence that the release sites was in the eastern region. An additional parameter that we can estimate with this model is the reproductive number. And now with COVID, everyone knows what this is. It is basically the number of infections that one infectious individual can cause. And if you have a reproductive number that's larger than one, you have an outbreak. If the reproductive number is one, you have a stable virus activity in that particular site. While if the reproductive number is less than one, then there is a reduction of the virus activity, potentially that might lead to extinction of the virus. And what you have in this plot are four lines. Each of those lines is one epoch where RHDV2 was present. This analysis refers to RHDV2. And it's quite clear that if we look at the first epoch, which is up to winter 2014, RHDV2 activities was mostly limited to the east region, where the reproductive number is well above one. And by 2016, the level of activity in the eastern region is much reduced, while we can easily detect, evidently detect an increase in activity in the central region, so Australia and Victoria, a little bit in Tasmania, but definitely in Western Australia. And a year later, South Australia, Victoria, and in Eastern region and Western Australia, the level of activity of the virus is much reduced, while there's still the virus actively replicating in Tasmania. And this special dynamic is exactly what we understand the virus does and how it maintains its presence in Australia by moving across the landscape and coming back on the same locations in different years. But it's very, very useful for management to be able to quantify the level of activity within each region. So we were quite happy that we have been able to do so. And similarly, we can do the same estimate data of arrival, and then there's not much difference from what we already seen before. The only mild difference is RHDV2, the arrival is estimated by this analysis a couple of months later, so more close to 2014, but not even that of that much. So just to recap what we have seen by applying those analyses, first molecular data, we have results that really resemble the results that we already obtained with prevalence data, which is quite interesting and give us confidence. Another element that give us confidence is the fact that there are some parameters values that we know what the true answer is, such as, for example, the data arrival of the release of RHDV1. And the fact that we can estimate those with high accuracy is clearly a good element. They give us information about how the model is actually realistic and how we can rely on those results to interpret the dynamics that we don't know about. It really seems that the initial dynamics for RHDV2 are quite similar to RHDV1, with the only difference being mentioned before. Everything seems to be happening at a faster rate with RHDV2. And based on those analyses, it seems also that the activity peak of RHDV2 already passed. That happened probably in somewhere between 2016 and 17. So it will be interesting to look at what happens next. And I should probably point out here that this analysis is done using sort of pure HDV2, so no recombinants. So it will be interesting to look at whether the recombinants are actually replacing, as the talk suggested, the HDV2, and whether we might see still some activity simply because we don't detect that with this analysis, simply because they've been replaced by the recombinants. And this analysis also provides a strong support that there is a negative correlation between RHDV1 and RHDV2 in the field. So I'm not sure whether I've still got time to get any questions or whether we'll do that later or what.
Thanks, Carlo. We do still have a minute or so for questions for Carlo. So if anyone's got any questions, please post them in the Q&A discussion. Otherwise, I might start off with a question for you. What sort of sample size and over what sort of spatial area or spatial resolution do you need to collect samples to enable you to be able to calculate virus reproductive rates and virus population size like you have done?
Yeah, that is a very good question, and this is something that we have been trying to address for a while now. A component of the study that's actually ongoing at the moment is exactly dealing with that question. We are running a bunch of simulations to try to estimate what's the minimum sample size that we need to be accurate in estimating those parameters. Clearly, in the case of RHDV2, the empirical evidence is there that with almost 200 samples, and then you get a very high resolution results. Keep in mind also that the fact that those samples actually covers pretty much the whole country, and it covers 2 or 4 years worth of dynamics of the virus. So probably there is a little bit of relationship between what the spatial scale you want to have information for, what's the timeline to whether that's limited to the most recent dynamic or how much back you want to go, and the interaction between those two elements. So if you're focusing on a very short period of time in a small areas, I would imagine you don't need that many. But probably if you want to do some large scale monitoring as we were trying to do here, I would probably suspect that 150 to 200 sequences is probably what you need to have that kind of high resolution power that we demonstrated with those analyses.